Almighty God, we love you. We pray that we don't God, I pray for the sins, for the failures of shortcomings, Lord. Move in the hearts and lives of these that are lost and undone without a Savior. Help us to be that light, to be that example, Lord. God, that we will jump the man up before them, Lord. They may see, oh, Lord, how wonderful you are, Lord Jesus. Lord, what a Savior today. Bless our song, bless our testimonies, God. Touch our sick and afflicted, God. Be those that are grieving today, those that are in the hospital, Lord Jesus, God. Wherever there may be the situation today, I pray that God tonight would you just move in the hearts and lives of our people that's lost and undone. Revive us again, we pray. Let it all be done for your glory, Lord, in Jesus' name. Facebook and don't know that when the scans came back, the cancer had only shrunk 1%, and they wanted immediately to do more chemo. Brother Charlie said he's going to take some time off on that, so amen, just to let his body heal up some. And I said, I completely understand,
amen,
that. You know, so let's continue to pray for Brother Charlie. We know a great physician that is able,
right,
to do far exceedingly above all above we could think or ask. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Katie, what's the number?
596.
596. Katie's got a birthday coming up here. Three more days. Johnny's just in 4 days.
Yours is 6 days.
Mine's in 6 days.
We're having the birthday party.
We're taking up donations now, ain't
we? Hey, party. Jamie, we're having the birthday party at the donut shop.
Are we?
For me and Johnny and Gail, so you might as well
come
over too.
And who?
Gail, my friend over there. He lives on the coast.
No, Gail.
Birthday party. Gail Miller, she was.
Yeah.
She died when I showed up.
When?
Monday.
All right, 596.
How long has it been?
On your
Somebody else got one?
What about 305?
I hear the
He did get in there.
Six, 12.
Yep. He said 12.
Do 6:12 and have fellowship together around the altar. All right, we'll not fellowship yet. What key is it in anyhow?
E flat.
Someone have an outspoken prayer request.
I like the church member called us now. They come in and prepare the family for the work, but she doesn't know the Lord. And Beverly Graves.
We have Virginia Dalton, and then they're not fit here. We had Lord today.
Sandy had surgery Tuesday of last week. I talked to Jim Sunday, and they had to, thought they was going to go in and do laparoscopic and have two places repaired. Well, when they got in there, the camera, it was a lot worse than they thought. It was four places that was ready to hernias, and anyhow, they ended up cutting her open and putting one great big patch in. And Jim says she's just mighty slow right now, so keep her in your prayers.
And also remember their son-in-law. He has an MS and some kind of a virus in the brain. When the MS is, and he has to go through the clinic trials.
Who's that?
Jim, Sandy's son-in-law.
This is up. Jason Valentine, he can even that box post off, and I asked him where he'd been, you know, and well, he had his elbow, he had trouble with his elbow, and he has got cancer, told him, just all probably in his 40s, he got cancer in his lymph nodes and in his eye, and they've already taken out one kidney. So I said, you care if I ask prayer for him? He said, no, I really appreciate it. So his name is Jason Valentine.
And me, my family. Jamie, remember Jason, he started his job this week. Don't forget to pray for our pastor and his family. Pray for one another. Remember all those that are sick and afflicted with this old cancer. Ask you, remember Brother Bud, he went in this morning to have his hernia surgery, and they had him on the table and the IVs in him, and I guess they decided that his heart wasn't strong enough to take it, so. So God, you got to send him home and told him that the only way they do it now is if it would be an emergency, they'd go ahead and take it out. But if not, which one you live with.
Jamie, my sister called me tonight, and her husband is in the hospital in Columbus. I'm not really sure what all's wrong with him, but something to do with, he was supposed to have surgery on the 8th, but they can't clear him because of his heart. And he's just probably in his 50s. Remember him in prayer. And remember Larry and I, we have a lot going on our family side, and a lot of changes. And some for the better. We hope they all are, but we never know. So it looks like I might not have any issues.
went down to that, and they lost everything, so any quotes, that's exactly what we've kind of started, so just pray for them, we can maybe look and see if we can help them out.
You know, you have a thought?
I kind of like to do this stuff.
Remember Doug, you know, he was really bad Sunday, and then Monday he was doing better, but I talked to, I think it's an aunt today, and she said that they had a medical respirator, yeah, last night. I haven't talked to her lately, but he's not well, so just remember him with the family especially.
We need the Lord to strengthen Charlie down there.
Amen.
Straight back up, because Lord knows he's been lazy long enough. A lot of things that need to be done that he could be doing, and we need him to get the strength to help do it. Get his work done. He needs some strength, so we need to pray for strength and get it better.
Have you ever been around one of the cancer centers? There's a lot of people that's going through a lot worse.
Yes.
And I just want to thank the Lord.
Yes.
For the help that I do have. For the blessings he bestows upon me.
Yep.
I mean, I, for him to say that I got to go through all this, I feel good.
Yeah.
Other than what they've done in this weekend.
Yeah.
I've got no energy or no way to.
Yeah. It'd take time, honey. That's poison they put in.
You can run, just not very far, what you're saying.
But anyway, there's a lot of priority. You look for people that's got cancer.
Yeah.
I feel so sorry for them young people. And
there's nothing worse than having to set aside people that don't come back in. You know, when you're down and you see those people, you don't know. When they don't come the next time, you wonder what happened.
Young people and kids.
Inflicted.
Someone else.
Larry and I were at the VA today, and I was in the waiting room, and there was this gentleman sitting there, and he was in his 50s, and he was talking to somebody else, and he said he has cancer as well, and he said that you don't realize how many people have it until you go through it, and there's probably a lot of them out there that haven't dealt with it, you know, so we need to just keep praying for cancer to be cured.
That's right. Everybody needs to pray for Michelle, you know, she's right back and forth up there. Keep her hands full to them. She's not been here, so we need to pray her back to church here.
Amen.
Also, there's a kid that's missing. That we need to make some phone calls and find out, you know, if they need help or a hand or a foot. One or the
other. Someone else.
Remember to find nursing home from the hospital to the shut-ins. They're all lost in one day in space.
Anybody else?
Pray for my son Ryan. And pray for me. This week they started intense physical therapy, and my body can't handle that. But I'm really sore, but I'm sure I'll. I need to pray for strength too, and I don't know the people, but there was a couple, they had a motorcycle benefit. They had buried their son 2 weeks ago, and they was on motorcycles, and their son was right behind them, and they pulled out and got hit by a truck, and they both got killed. So that son has buried a brother, now he has to bury a mom and dad. So like I said, I have no idea. I don't even know where they're from. So, but God does.
Jamie, remember Patty Blessing as well. There's God.
Someone else. You know, we didn't take 30 seconds or 45 seconds to take these requests.
Quite a few
here tonight. A lot of requests. We've let our requests be made known. Now let's talk with the Father.
Yeah.
get a hold of the throne. Anybody else? Brother John, would you lead us?
Dear Lord God, dear Heavenly Father, we come to the Lord in your name,
thank you. Never die.
there, and I'm gonna stand outside, I don't know, you know, you could, you know. Got a big hearing aid yesterday, and I'm telling you, boy, I can hear it.
Anyone else want to brag on the Lord? Someone have a song?
I want to stand up and say, God answered my prayer. I know I'm spoken prayer. He answered it. And okay. It's okay. And just, I love God for that, and I praise you for that.
Bless your bread.
I'm really happy right now that he answered that prayer. Only God can do that. I thank him for that.
Amen. Amen. Well,
I've read this before, Rory. Again, I found some pages of Bible. There was a little boy on the week's first day coming home from Sunday school, watching on wandering on the way. He scuffed his shoes into the grass. Found a caterpillar. He found a fluffy milkweed pot, a good eye hole of fiber, a bird nest in the tree above, so the wife is placed on the high. With just another wonder that caught his ear up. A neighbor watched this cricket course and hailed him from the lot. He asked him where he'd been that day and what was going on. I've been to Sunday school, he said, and he turned a piece of sod, and picking up a worm, he smiled. I learned a lot from God. That's a fine way, the neighbor said, for a boy to spend his time. Now, if you can tell me where God is, I'll give you a brand new dime. Quickly the fly at the answer came. The boy said without complaint, I'll give you a dollar, mister, if you can tell me where God ain't.
Amen. That's the truth.
That's a good one.
You can always stand up to out of the Lord tonight. Thank you for your all the travel and mercy you allowed me to get to. Thank you, man. 3 or 4 months ago, I came home at night from work, and Cheryl's been laying in bed. Now I come home, I don't know what she's doing. She might be out in the orchard planting flowers or paint rooms or whatever, but I just praise God for it in her life. Love the church, love the Lord.
Busting wood.
Yeah, you spent two pick up those wood last night. Yeah, you get right in the end. I just can't believe you put out good against me. I went to bed crying in pain last night. I was serving all my first dad. Christ is the best thing ever. Every muscle I have is the heart that's aching. I just love the Lord for those things, you know, because I can do that. Gary came home after work 12 hours and had to get a best stuff for us, the truth, and clean up the kitchen and bless me with homework and everything. I just about got a great painting today. I just lift my hand, you know, that he's intervened. Helped me along the way, no matter what, in my valley, my God was there, Jamie, and he has lifted me up. Even when I think, oh, I can't do this, I go on and get one and do it. I know I shouldn't, but you know what? He has a reason for me to be able to do all the things I do, and I'm going to take every minute out of it and give him praise for every bit of it. He's good to my kids, he's good to my grandchildren. I just want to thank him for what all he's done. I just love him, you know. I love him to be able to come to Bible study and to learn, just like I said today, how we're going to learn and how to live if we're not here.
at your hearing. You're going to get Jonathan first, so you will.
He talked about the outside union. I knew what he's talking about. Somebody else. Trying to bust John's bubble. He knows what you know, right, brother? Gospel according to James. Old Camel Knees. That was his nickname. Old Camel Knees. He prayed so much that he had calluses on his knees. Well, that's a pretty good reputation to have, isn't it?
Yeah.
You use a few of them in today's society, couldn't you? James chapter 4. James chapter 4. Hello? Can you hear me now? That's pretty good timing on that one. I'd have to talk to Larry back there about that, John. So Elijah, your word of advice, be careful what you say. James chapter 4. In James chapter 4, James starts out pretty harsh. But he, about halfway through it, seemed like he just swings from one angle completely to another and gives us some really good advice. He said, from whence cometh wars and fightings among you? Come they from hence, even from your own lust, that war after your members? What causes churches to split?
Carnal-minded Christians.
People walking in their flesh and not in the spirit, which entails everything that you guys just said. Whether it be gossip, again, how many times have we heard about churches splitting when they're talking about changing the color of the carpet? I mean, I know churches that have split for taking a picture down off the wall that Grandma put up there 100 years ago. Bless her heart. If Grandma knew that picture was off the church wall now, she'd roll over in her grave. If she's able, she'd get up and move out of that cemetery out back. I mean, stupid things like that, folks. People, when we get in our flesh and it becomes about us or our families, or it's more important than that, than it is about Jesus Christ and winning someone else to Him, which is the sole purpose of the church. Now, again, I don't mean to keep beating on a dead drum, but this is not the church. This is. Boy, if you listen to Adrian Rogers today, man, he flat nailed it down. How the people, you know, he said, you know, you won't bring something in the church house to eat, but then you set it to house and fill the temple completely up overflowing. I mean, he just went all do different things that people do. God dwells here. And when His people come in here, that means God's in here. Now, again, hey, I'm like him. This, thank God for this building that's set apart for the service and work to a place to assemble, but it is not the church. We are the church, and we've got to understand that. And we make sure that this is not about us. It's not about the people that built this building or paid to build this building in 1986, I think, is when it was finished, 86, 87, somewhere through there. It's not about them that gave all that money. This whole thing is about Jesus Christ and the price that he paid for sin. And when we get into, what is lust? We got to, when we think of lust, we think of the sexual desire from one individual to another. That's not always it. That's a type of. But there are many things today that to lust means to strongly desire whatever it may be. There's a lot of them. If we lust after the things of God, you know what? The Bible commends us for that. To lust after the things of God. It's when we lust after the things of the flesh, regardless of what it may be, when we don't get our way or we don't get our voice heard. All right. He said, from whence cometh wars and fightings among you? In other words, why? That's what we could put in there instead of whence. Where did it come from? Why is it there? Because of your lust that you war in your members. Ye lust and have not. Ye kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. Ye fight and war, yet ye have not, because you ask not. Now, out of all of that verse, on verse number 2 there, is there any good thing about that? Everything about that is him telling them what they are doing. But the most important thing there is that you don't have because you don't ask. But listen, we'll get on into what he said here in a minute. But look at what he said there in the first part of it. You lust, you desire to have, and you don't have. Ye kill. Ye kill and desire to, you know, what got Ahab and Jezebel in trouble with God? The number, now I remember, now I know that they were idol worshipers, but what really drew attention to them from God? Does anybody know? Ahab walked by the vineyard of Naboth, and he desired to have that. And he offered another vineyard and double the money that that vineyard was worth. And Naboth said, this is mine inheritance that I received of my fathers, and I'm not letting it go. And he went home, and he laid on his bed, and he pouted. And Jezebel come in and said, what's wrong with you? You're the king. Why are you acting this way? Well, I asked for Nahab to give me his vineyard, and he wouldn't give me, and I offered him double money. She said, you're the king. My God, get up. So she sent people down, and we know the story. It is that she had people lie against him, brought false witnesses against him, and they killed him. And when they found out that she got word back from her people that she had bought off, she went in and said, now he's dead, go take that what you wanted. You desire to have and you kill. You know what happened? The man of God come on the scene. They thought they had it covered up. Nobody knew what was going on except Jezebel and these people. Ahab really didn't know how he died. All he knew, he was dead. But Jezebel and the people that bear the false witness, they knew. When you think you've got your sin covered up, be sure your sin will find you out. So you desire to have and ye kill and cannot obtain. Did he ever really get that vineyard? When he got down, was walking through the vineyard, I mean, there was a prophet of God. Did he get to enjoy it? The devil will paint you a beautiful picture, but there's sorrow and heartache amen, behind all of that, behind the smoke screen that he's sending up for you, and cannot obtain. You fight in war, yet you had not. In other words, you struggle to get, but you still don't get it. You have not because you ask not. Here's the thing. If you ask of God, I mean, Hannah knows that if she comes to Dad and she asks in the right way, if it is possible and it's beneficial for her, guess what? Dad will do it. Right? If we do that for our earthly children, how much more shall our heavenly Father do for us? If we come in the right, humble spirit, asking God, you see, here's the thing. We have to ask ourselves, is everything beneficial to us? Is it going to help us or hurt us? Do we really need it? If we desire, if we search after the things of God, but here's what the scriptures say. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all entails all these other things shall, what's the next part? Be added unto you. So why wouldn't we just seek after God and his things and allow these other things to come in? Right? You have not because you ask not. Here's why. You ask and you receive not because you ask amiss. In other words, you ask for something that you know is not good for you. You ask amiss that you may consume it upon your lust. You adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enemy of God, enmity of God, whomsoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God? In other words, if all you ever do is hang around worldly people, I'm not saying that you can have be a friend to someone that is not a Christian, but you can't go out and do the things that they constantly do. That's what this verse is saying. Verse number 5. Do you think that the scripture saith, in vain the spirit that dwelleth in us lusteth for lusteth to envy? Why do people do things? Why do people get offended at someone else being blessed? Another word for jealousy is what? This word right here. To be envious means to be jealous of someone that's being blessed, desiring to have something else somebody has. Verse 6, but he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. I wish these fellows that are out there that would just tell me that you can walk up to the throne room of God and demand from the Holy Spirit to do anything, to read this verse. We've got to come in the right manner before God. Right? I mean, I'm telling you, if they walked up and they just told me, you're going to do this, that number one, you don't ever tell me that. You're going to do this or else. Because else is what I'm going to do. Right? That's just simply the choice of the matter today. When we come, we've got to come humbly. And if we ask in that right manner, in that right spirit, God will giveth freely and bridleth not, right? But he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth to... Listen, people always quote the last part. Submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. Not have to, he will flee. But you've got to do that first part. If you are not submitted to God, then God's not in control, you are, and you'll lose. Right? So, submit yourself, therefore, unto God, then resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. Listen, you draw nigh unto God, and he will draw nigh unto you. Well, that's powerful. We're getting into some powerful stuff here. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. What does it mean to be double-minded? A double-minded person is someone that can't make up their mind. You've got to settle it in your heart. Focus on one thing. If you cannot focus, if you're trying to, you're not going to win.
I think it's kind of like being also being lukewarm. I mean, not double-minded can be more than just lukewarm, but the people that are living, you know, for God this minute, next minute, kind of doing it. They're double-minded in a way.
If God be God, serve God. Baal be God, serve Baal. Right? Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. We've done covered that and down. Be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned into mourning and your joy to heaviness. Now, I'm telling you, there's nobody runs around quoting that verse.
True.
Why should we? Is there a reason that we should? Listen to what it said now. Be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned into mourning and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord. And here's the next part. Here's why we should. And he shall lift you up. Where does your joy come from? Does your joy come from your spouse? Your true joy, your true happiness, your true peace. Does it come from your spouse? Where does it come from? Where? The Lord. So if you're double-minded, you fellas remember watching the movie The War Room downstairs? When that lady finally got sick and tired of it, she said, "Devil, it's time for you to leave. This house is under new management. The source of my joy is not in my job. It's not in my home. It's not in my children. It's not in my husband. It's not in our finances. The joy, source of my joy, or the joy of the Lord, that's our strength." If we're basing everything on material things that we can see, then we're going to be disappointed. But if we're looking and focusing on things that are unseen, the possibilities are endless. Speak not evil of one another, brethren. He that speaketh evil of his brother and judgeth his brother speaketh evil of the law and judgeth the law. But if thou judge the law, then thou art not a doer of the law, but a judge. So where in the scriptures does the Spirit or does the Bible give you and I a right to judge one another? I mean, this is pretty plain on that, isn't it? Now, I realize that there are people that take that to the extreme. You know, I can live my life the way I want to. You don't have the right to judge me. You don't have the right to opinion. But when we give the righteous judgment comes from where? The Word. The Word of God.
Judging is condemning someone too, saying, "Well, I'm for sure that person's going to hell." It's the difference between looking at the fruits and saying, "I need to kind of stay away from that person," and then saying, "That person's going to hell, they have no chance." To judge someone is really what you're condemning. I mean, in my opinion, if I say you're going to hell, that's judging. Christ, you get a hold of that person, the Holy Ghost, and clean.
I mean, if I know you're a thief, And I call you a thief. I feel like if I know you're a thief and you stole from me, and you're a thief and I call you a thief, I'm not being judgmental.
That's, I agree with you 100%. But what we do is we categorize people for their sins. And we put them in places that they don't belong, and we make it as if that God can't reach them because of this type of sin, because we have categorized. I'm going to tell you something. Lying is as bad as the rest of it. Covetousness is as bad as the rest of it. So we have to understand today, if we're going, again, you have the right to call a liar a liar, but they're still a sinner. A sinner is a sinner is a sinner is a sinner. And here's the thing, for all have sinned, right? And come short of the glory of God. So when we judge, we have to make sure, number one, again, we are not fruit inspectors. You know what a fruit inspector is? It's called quality control. I mean, when you go down to the auction, they'll have number one tomatoes, they'll have number two tomatoes, and then they'll have canned tomatoes, and then they'll have juice tomatoes. You know what I'm saying? And those have been judged by their qualities. We don't have that right, folks. I can look and say, that's a tomato. Right? I just think, where's the knife? And let's start slicing it. There is one lawgiver. How many?
One.
Who is the lawgiver, by the way? Yes and no. Okay. Who is the lawgiver? Who? Yes and no. That's what I just told Joe. Joe, just say God. But God who? Where did the word come from? In the beginning was the... And the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the same was in the beginning. So again, the Word, the law was handed down by Christ. When Moses was on top of the mountain and God came walking by, it was not God the Father, folks. It was pre-incarnate. It's a Christophany, I think, is the word that to use. Is a pre-Bethlehem appearance of Christ. When it was God that came to Abraham's tent and sat down in it with two angels and ate goat, roasted goat, and some kind of cake that was baked on the fire, and I don't know what else they had. Amen. As the two angels went on to Sodom and Gomorrah, it was God, that being Jesus Christ, that walked with Abraham and said, shall I hide from Abraham the thing I'm going to do? Right? It was God that came down later and wrestled. It was Jesus Christ, or God, however how you have it, that came down later and wrestled with Jacob.
So what God?
Jesus Christ, God. God the Son. God, I don't think God the Father has ever moved off the throne. Why? If God's on that throne, how could the cherubs be around that throne 24/7 crying, holy, holy, holy? Anytime you see God off the throne, it is God the Son. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. They all work together.
He's the lawmaker.
Huh? They all work together, but who actually physically carved his finger in those stones was Christ. I mean, he's the one that gave those first tablets to Moses. He could, all he could see was, remember, this was his prayer before he, there in the garden before he died. He said, Father, restore unto me the glory that I had with you from the foundation of the world. He left that glory in heaven, came to this earth, took upon the form of a man, and went back to heaven and was restored to glory. Right? All right, there is one lawgiver who is able to save. Who saves a man? What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of... Who is able to save? Here's the thing. We are able to draw nigh unto God through Christ. God doesn't draw men to himself. He draws men unto Jesus, and Jesus brings them to God the Father. Right? Isn't that how it works? How does he draw? By the Spirit, the God, the other part of that Trinity. Through the Spirit to the Son, that he may present us blameless to the Father. So there's one lawgiver who is able to save and to destroy. Who art thou that judgest another? Who will be the judge at the end? Christ. Remember when he was before the Pharisees and they were accusing him of a lot of the things and they were judging him? He said, I have many things to judge you of, but it ain't time yet. Remember that? When you see this, that picture of the great white throne, who's sitting on the throne is the Lamb of God that's slain before the foundation of the world.
And Jesus is the best one to judge, because no one can say that Christ doesn't know what it's like, because he came and suffered every temptation. The Father committed all the judgment to the Son. And who better?
Go back. What'd you just say, Derek? The Father hath done what?
He's committed all
judgment to the Son until he shall put all rule and authority under his feet. All powers given unto him in heaven and in earth. And when he's put all rule and authority, when Satan is in hell, the false beasts and the prophets and everyone that's not written in the book of life is cast into hell. When all that's over, he will walk up before the throne of the Father and relinquish that power back to God, that God might be all in all. Where did you find that at? In this book. So it's Christ that died. It is Christ that... I mean, when we leave here as a church, where are we going? Judgment seat of who? Christ. He's the judge. When he comes, who's coming on the white horse to make war with the devil and his people? Christ. So again, God the Father, I can't find anywhere in the scriptures that God the Father moved off the throne. All things were made by him. The speaking of Christ in John chapter 1. All things were made by him and for him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Let us make man in our own image. Us, who is the us? Huh? Without him, if out him was not anything made, the us there to me is Christ. In the image of God created thee him. All right. Getting right down to the nitty gritty. Go to now, ye that say, verse 13, today or tomorrow ye will go into such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get gain. What Paul or James is saying here is, boys, listen, you fellas that say this, listen at me. You guys say that you've got everything planned out. I'm going to move to Columbus. I'm going to live in Columbus for the next year. I've got a promise of a job up there that pays me such and such money, and I'm going to work up there for a year. At the end of that year, I'll have all my bills paid off, and I won't need all that money to live on. I'll do this, and I'll do that. I wish I could tell you how many men I have saw in my life that worked right. I mean, all they work for is retirement. And within 6 months of retirement, they ain't no more. They're gone. Some within a month. Rhonda's dad come home from work, was in the operating room the next day. 6 months later to the day, he died with cancer. Was it 5 months? 6 months to the day. Worked 30-some years in the mines, either on a strip or in the ground. Whereas, ye know not what be on tomorrow, for what is your life? It is even as a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. We all got that part. What is our life? It's a vapor that, I mean, we all grasp that. Especially, I mean, you young people now, you think, man, another 50 years, I can retire or whatever. Andrew, you're 16, 17. How old are you? So he's 16. Get that? Almost 17. Why didn't you just say I'm 16? So, and get this. Another 54 years from now, Andrew, you can retire because you want to be 70 before you can retire and get all Social Security. But let me tell you something about that next 54 years. It'll be here before you know it. And the older you get, the faster time goes. How many will agree to that, folks? Right? Remember the thing from days of our lives, it would come on and there would be that big hourglass. As sands through the hourglass, so goes the days of our lives. You know the thing about that? You turn that hourglass over, it don't look like there's hardly any sand twinkling through there. But you take your eye off of it, look back, and it's bigger, and it's bigger, and and it seems like all of a sudden, this thing just says, whoosh, and it's empty. That's the way I'm telling you, me and my wife, we've been married 27 years, and she just thinks it was yesterday. Cheryl.
Bring the house to the Lord, you sure ain't gonna make her laugh.
All right, maybe I think it was just yesterday.
Jamie, if you don't mind me saying, I think a great example is Job. Job said, surely I'm going to die. And he didn't have gotten a good age, but he thought he was going to die with the children he had. He thought he was going to live in prosperity because of what he had seen. Now, Job was a righteous man, but he assumed. And I heard a saying, I love it, it says, you can plan, and it's good to plan. You can assume, but at the end of the day, if it doesn't line up with God's will, it won't be. I mean, I like to think, when I'm older, I can have a family. I could die tomorrow. I could die going home tonight. I may never make it to college if it's not God's will. And I think another good example, like I said, if you don't mind, is Ecclesiastes. A lot of times we think vanities of vanities means everything's meaningless, but that's not necessarily the case. What I interpret as well is that a vanity is basically, it's like a vapor of breath. Vanity, vanity. Everything, we work for all this stuff, and we chase gold, we chase all this stuff. But within a vapor, in a breath, we're dead.
Think about Solomon. He brought up Solomon here. He's talking about him. Let's think about Solomon. Is there ever a man that's any richer than Solomon ever been up on the face of this earth? Is there ever a man, I'm talking about a man, not talking about Christ, ever been a man any smarter than Solomon? What Solomon said was, boys, I've had it all, I've tried it all, I've done it all, and I found out it all don't mean nothing. For know this, every work shall be brought into judgment. That's what Solomon said. He said, for the whole duty of man is to fear God and to keep his commandments. The rest of it, he said, don't matter. All right. Let's back to verse 14. Whereas ye know not what tomorrow, what shall be on the morrow. Do we have anybody in here that's able to predict what's going to happen tomorrow? All right. Does anybody in here know exactly what the lucky lottery, winning lottery numbers are for Saturday night?
And if you do, can I speak with you?
I mean, I'm willing to split 50-50 if you know.
It wouldn't be gambling then.
It wouldn't be gambling then, because you know, right? We don't know. The thing we know about life that we can bank on is life is uncertain. I mean, I realize there is technology now today that you can go down and you can take one of your eggs and he can take his sperm, whatever, and they can actually figure that out and make sure that that child is a boy or a girl.
But I got to tell you something, if it ain't possible.
That's right. They don't
it ain't
but
they can shove them things together.
I realize.
But
what I'm saying is, which one of us in here knew what our child was going to be when it was conceived? No one. That's the way life is. We don't have any guarantees. I mean, how many people thought your health would be where it is right now?
How many of you thought you'd be sitting in church at Free Will Baptist Church?
I'm going to tell you, I grew up on Spice Creek. All right, I never heard of Puritan Free Will Baptist Church.
Well, I mean, no, just like
that. I mean, let...
I thought I'd be a Methodist, to tell you the truth, because I have brothers, I have people up there that I love, that if I called and needed something, I thought for sure I was going to be a Methodist. I didn't think I was going to be right here at Puritan. But guess where God...
Yeah, when we first come here, Dorothy was constantly telling Gary about, oh, if you get a chance, stop out, so we didn't have it, you'd be service at the Archer. Let's be honest with you, I didn't want to do it anymore. Stepped out, didn't speak. If you don't speak to me on the street, why would I want to go to all safety? You know.
How many of them knew you on the street, though?
Quite a bit, but they knew me.
They knew the old Cheryl.
They knew the old me.
They knew the old Cheryl.
But you know what? I would take down for a there ain't not one person in this church I wouldn't make down for that. And that's the truth. I thank God for everyone. I love you all. And I've never dreamed I'd be here. And when we came, the Lord told us that night we were on our way home that this was our home. And we knew we would be here.
There's a fellow sitting in this building. Probably more than one. There's one sitting real close to me that swore he would never come back to this church.
Yep. There he sits on that front pew.
We don't know what tomorrow holds, right?
And we love him more than anything.
You know, it's a blessing that we don't know. All right? But there are curses to that. You know, like we've had loved ones that have passed away and we didn't get that last chance to say goodbye. Such as my brother. And what I wouldn't give to hug his neck one more time and tell him I love him. I mean, you understand what I'm saying? We don't know. So what I'm saying is, make today the best day. Because if it may be your last, and if it's not yours, it may be someone else's you love. Make today be your best day. Verse number 15. For you ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this and do that. Now, that don't mean that... I looked at an individual one time. I went and visited him. And I said, I'll see you at church Sunday. I remember where I saw him at. If it's the Lord's will, I said, let me tell you something. I said, it's his will for you to be in his house. All right? Now, I realize things can hinder, all right, again, if we can get sick or whatever, but people use that as a crutch. If you do not put it as a priority, it's easy to find an excuse not to.
Oh, absolutely.
Right?
The only reason not to go to church, if you lay there, you can find tons of reasons.
Or read the Bible, or pray, or visit, or whatever the case may be. It's all about where is your priority at? What are you seeking? Remember, seek ye first the kingdom of God, if it's your will, Lord. Because here's what Christ, you know, and someone, I heard someone teach on this the other day, talking about what people deem as the Lord's Prayer, said it's not really the Lord's Prayer at all. It's a model prayer for us, because in that prayer it says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, or our trespasses. And Christ never had any, so it can't be the Lord's Prayer. He couldn't pray that prayer. It is our prayer. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. Right here. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. When we pray that, do we need to ask God for our daily bread? Wait a minute now. You have not because you... Now I realize again, God knows what our needs are, right? Everybody believe that? If we seek our needs, not our wants, and the kingdom of God first, he'll give us our wants. But, don't you love with that little word? It means something else is coming, doesn't it? For we ought to say, if the Lord will, we would do this or do that. But, now ye rejoice in your boastings. All such rejoicing is good for you.
Evil.
Bad. When we fail to put God in our plan, it's an evil plan. Therefore, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not is what?
Sin.
Therefore, to him that knoweth to do good. Boy, that's a big... I mean, that verse there is pretty well about as big as John 3:16 in your Bible. To him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him... Now, again, how do I know what I'm supposed to be doing? Did you say, Derek?
Spirit of God.
The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. So if we're being led by the Spirit of God, remember, it goes back to how we started this thing. If we're walking in the flesh to fulfill the lust of the flesh, whatever it may be, I mean, remember, I can't turn that overtime down. I've got to get out there and work. Where have I made my goal at? Where's my priorities at? It's money's not the root of all evil. It's the love of. We've already covered that. All right? So therefore to him that doeth do good doeth not, to him it is sin. One more chapter in James, Lord willing. And then we will move on to 1 Peter. All right? All hearts free. Continue to pray for Charlie as he gets stronger. that God will lead and guide him. There's a lot of prayer requests. Again, take these home with you. Be praying about the services this weekend. Pray ye one for another. That's a commandment, right? Anything else? Let's stand. I will.